Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, we are going to continue our analysis of the Wright-Fisher model. I quickly remind you that in the previous two videos, we were already able to answer two important questions about the model. The first question is who wins with which probability? And second question, what is, at least in average, the expected amount of time it takes until we have fixation of the system? And here are the answers. So first, we were able to prove that starting with X individuals of type 1 in the Wright-Fisher model, the probability that eventually type 1 outcompetes type 0 is equal to this probability Px equal to X over N, the initial fraction of individuals of type 1. We were also able to compute exactly the expected time to fixation, not for the Wright-Fisher model itself, but at least for its diffusion approximation. And we found that starting with a fraction x of type 1 individuals at time 0, it's going to take, in average, an amount of time equal to negative 2x log x plus 1 minus x log 1 minus x unit of time for the process to fixate in a configuration where all the individuals are of the same type. In this video, we are going to answer a third important question about the Wright-Fisher model. So at least that's an important question from the point of view of population genetics. And so here is the problem. Assume that you have a large population with capital N individuals evolving according to the Wright-Fisher model. From this population at the present time, take a subset of little n individuals. Little n is much smaller than capital N. You choose those individuals uniformly at random from the population. And the question is, how far do you need to go back in time to find their most recent common ancestor? So it turns out that this process, there is another stochastic process related to the Wright-Fisher model that keeps track of the genealogy of those individuals and from which we can deduce the answer to this question, how far do we need to go back in time to find the most recent common ancestor? And this process is called Kingman's coalescent. It turns out that it's pretty difficult, exactly like for the expected value of the time to fixation, to answer this question when capital N is fixed. So instead, we are going to again take the limit when N goes to infinity and answer the question in the diffusion approximation limit. Again, limit when N goes to infinity of some kind of rescaled version of the Wright-Fisher model. So before I describe this stochastic process called Kingman's coalescent in the diffusion limit, I'm going to start with a picture so that we kind of make sense of what the process should look like. And then only after, I'm going to give you simulation pictures of the process and also a more rigorous definition from which we can work and answer the question. So first, I'm going to draw a line here representing the population at the present time. Here we have our capital N individuals. N is very large, and from this population I'm going to take maybe four individuals. So we have a subset of four individuals chosen uniformly at random. Let's assume that time goes down like that. So that means that up there you have the past. And what we want to do is draw some kind of picture that's going to look like a random tree that keeps track of the ancestors of those individuals. So what I'm going to do, because we don't care at all about the location of the individuals in the Wright-Fisher model, I'm going to just draw vertical lines going up in this picture, and you are going to have four vertical lines starting from each of those four points going up and doing nothing else than that, as long as those four individuals have four distinct ancestors. And maybe this looks like that, this, this, and this. So up to that time, all those four individuals have four different ancestors, and maybe at exactly that time, those two individuals are going to have a common ancestor. And I'm going to represent that in the picture by just drawing a line here. And we are going to say that at this time, there is what we call a coalescing event, meaning that those two individuals have the same ancestor. Then I'm going to keep going back in time until we have only one common ancestor for all the individuals. So here, I'm going to start from the middle and keep going up again. Here, those lines also, they keep going up, and maybe at this time, now we find the common ancestor of those two individuals. And then we can keep going, and maybe here we find their most recent common ancestor. So if you look at this picture, the question we want to answer about how far do we need to go back in time to find the most recent common ancestor of those four individuals, you can read the answer here. It's exactly going to be this length here. The question is, what is this time here? How long you have to wait? How far you need to go back in time to find the most recent common ancestor? And we are going to call this time TIMRCF, or most recent common ancestor. So the goal is to compute the expected value of this random variable, not for the Wright-Fisher model itself, but again for the diffusion approximation of the Wright-Fisher model. So now, before I show you simulation pictures and a rigorous definition of this object called Kingman's coalescent, you see that there are two different aspects that would describe this structure. So the first aspect is the topology, which is which two branches are going to first coalesce and so on. And by this, for instance, I mean that you see that I can draw the tree exactly like we did here. So that's one first topology. The actual time at which we have coalescing events in terms of topological point of view does not matter. That's not something that would influence the topology. But to give you another example of tree with a different topology that maybe would look like this, and then you have another coalescing event here, and then the third one is here. So here you have two different trees starting with four branches, but you see that they have a very different topology. So the first question is about the topology of the tree, of this random tree, even if the actual topology does not matter to compute the expected value of this time to the most recent common ancestor, that's still an aspect that is included in the definition of this stochastic process, Kingman's coalescent. And obviously, the other important question we want to answer is how far do we need to go back in time to find the most recent common ancestor? And to be able to compute the expected value of this time, we are going to study also the time to the first coalescing event and the time between the first and second coalescing event, between the second and the third, and so on. So here is a picture of a mathematician John Kingman, who introduced this stochastic process that keeps track of the genealogy of the individuals in the diffusion approximation of the Wright-Fisher model. And here are also actual pictures of Kingman's coalescent. So on the right, it's just a picture that looks a lot like the picture I drew on the board. And you see on the right, we can define those time between coalescing events. That's what we are going to study eventually to compute the expected value of the time to the most recent common ancestor. And on the left, that's an actual simulation pictures of Kingman's coalescent generated by a computer program. Now, more formally, Kingman's coalescent is this process that we write K sub T, so K for Kingman. This evolves in continuous time, even if the Wright-Fisher model is a discrete time process, because we are looking at the genealogy in the diffusion approximation. KT is going to be a continuous time process. It turns out that it's a continuous time Markov chain. And you see that what's interesting is that the process is in fact defined on a set of partition of the set 1, 2, up to little n, representing the n individuals. And you see that always the initial state is going to be the partition with n singleton, singleton 1, singleton 2, up to singleton n, and the last state is going to be the partition that consists of only one set with all n elements. So I'm going to show you this sequence of partition, for instance, for this picture that we drew here. So just to explain a little bit how that works, and to explain also that why indeed using as a state space the set of all the possible partitions of the set 1 through n, or in this case 1 through 4, indeed is going to describe the topology of this tree. So for instance, in this example, the initial partition is always the same. That's going to be, I'm going to draw, to do some parentheses instead of braces. It's a little bit easier and less messy. So we start with this partition here. 1, 2, 3, 4. So that represents those four individuals here. And you see that the process is going to be in this state at time zero. Then after you go back in time, let's say that now for the Kingman's coalescent, when you go back in time, in fact, you increase time t for Kingman's coalescent. And so up to that time, that's the state of the process. And the next state visited by the process corresponds to only those three branches. And for this partition, that's going to correspond to, like, we are going to represent this coalescing event between individual 1 and 2 by merging those two sets. So you see that each time there is we visit a new state, we have one coalescing event, and that means that we lose one of the sets in this partition. And by losing, I mean we have one less set in the partition, and this happens because two sets of the partitions are going to merge together. So here we start from this state, then after we are going to move to 1, 2 coalesce. So the next state is going to be like this, 1, 2, and then singleton 3, singleton 4. Then next state, you see next thing happening is 3 and 4 are going to coalesce. So the next state is going to be this partition, 1, 2, and then 3, 4. And then the last state is always the same. Eventually, after three steps, if you start from n individuals, or in general, after n minus one steps, if you start with n individuals, you only have everything merged together, and you only have one set in your partition, and the final state is exactly going to be the partition 1, 2, 3, 4. So this here shows the sequence of state visited by the process for this picture. Now it's the same for that picture. The topology here are identical, but you see that for this picture things are different. Instead of going to, you know, from so you start going from indeed this to this partition to this partition in this feature, because you have coalescing events with 1 and 2, but then 1 and 2 are going to merge with 3. So that means that instead of having this state, for this realization, what you are going to have is the set 1, 2, 3 and the singleton 4, and then they are going to merge and you obtain this. So what's interesting is to see that this choice of the state space using all the possible partition of this set of n individuals is indeed going to describe the topology of this tree. So now the question is, what is exactly the sequence of states visited? Well, it turns out that because the evolution rules are completely symmetric, if you start with 4 individuals, you have exactly 4 choose 2, which is equal to 6 possible pairs of individuals. And in fact, each of those 6 possible pairs are going to be, you choose one of those 6 possible pairs uniformly at random, and that's the 2 individuals that are going to coalesce, and so on. Okay? So eventually, what you do at each step to really generate this sequence. And because everything happens uniformly at random, is you start with n sets, you choose two of those sets at random, and you put them together. That gives you one less set in your partition, because you have two sets that merge together. And then you keep doing that with all the sets and so on. And after n minus one steps, you have only one big set in your partition. So, for instance, to illustrate that, just the topology of the tree, what you can do is the following. Here, I'm going to take four different markers that corresponds to the four individuals. I choose different colors to say that they are, you know, different individuals. And so the way you are going to generate the evolution rules, if you look at only the embedding Markov chain associated to this continuous time Markov chain, and you only keep track of the sequence of states, can be reproduced just with those markers by just saying, well, you have four, you take two at random, let's say this one and this one, and then I'm going to take some rubber band and I'm going to just put them together like this. So that's what we are doing, and then eventually those two ones are together, and then I have two more like this. So here, from four different pens, I end up with three groups of pens instead. Then next step, now you have three, and that gives you three choose two possible pairs. You choose one at random, so you choose two blocks at random, maybe those two ones, if I want to reproduce this feature. If I want to reproduce this feature, then I would take those ones. So for instance, let's take those ones, and then I take another rubber band, and then I put them together like this. And now my partition here corresponds to that. The three branches here coalesce, that corresponds to those three pens, and then this one is alone. And then last event, there is no choice. If we choose one pair here, there is only one possibility. We put them together, one more rubber band, and then we put them together, and we are done. From four pens at the beginning, we end up with a group of four pens representing only one group. And so you see that the four pens represent each of the four individuals, but the three rubber bands that I used represent the three coalescing events in this picture. So now that we are done explaining how the Kingman's coalescent, how the process keeps track of the topology of the tree, we are going to go back to our original question, which is how far do we need to go back in time to find the most recent common ancestor, and again find the expected value of this time to the most recent common ancestor. So the time is defined rigorously by looking at the infimum of time t, such that the partition kt consists of only one set. That's exactly the time at which the first time at which all the individuals are going to have indeed a common ancestor. The main theorem says that the expected value of this time to the most recent common ancestor in the diffusion approximation is equal to 2 times 1 minus 1 over n. So I rewrote the result here. That's what we want to prove. And the first step to do this is to decompose this stopping time here into a sum of inter-arrival times between consecutive coalescing events, a little bit like in the picture I showed you before. And so to illustrate that, I'm going to draw again a picture like this. So let's say that maybe we have a realization that looks like that. So this, this, and this. So let's say that our tree structure looks like that. We start with four individuals. I'm going to call that time here T4. T4 is going to be, by definition, the time it takes starting with four individuals to have the first coalescing event. Then I'm going to call this next time here, between the two coalescing events, T3. And this one here, this length here, is going to be T2. So in general, Tj, let's say, is going to be the time it takes to go from j branches in the system to j minus 1 branches in the system. And in terms of the process kt itself, is how long it's going to take to go from a partition with j subset to a partition with j minus one subset. So that's the quantity we are going to define. Clearly, to find the expected value of this time, the only thing we need is to find the expected value of all those times by linearity of the expected value of the time to the most recent common ancestor is just the sum of the expected values. And it turns out that most of the work is to really understand the random variable T2. Once we understand T2, we can easily deduce the distribution of the over inter-arrival time between consecutive coalescing events. So for that, I'm going to start by looking at the probability that T2 is strictly larger than T, let's say. So T2 strictly larger than T. And so to understand this probability, so I'm going to draw another picture. So let's assume that here you have your very large population with capital N individuals. We just look at two individuals chosen uniformly at random in this population. And first question is, in order to compute this, what is the probability that those two individuals have the same parent? So clearly, well, let's say that the parent of this one is whatever. The probability that this one has the same parent is exactly going to be 1 over n, okay? Because this one has n possible choices for the parent. So the probability that this guy chooses the same parent as this one is just 1 over n, okay? So that means that going back in time, at each time step, from the point of view of the Wright-Fisher model evolving in discrete time, there is a probability 1 over n that indeed those two individuals have the same parent. Which means that the time you have to wait until indeed you have a first success, meaning some coalescing event, is just going to be exactly a geometric random variable with parameter 1 over n. Now, I need also, because we look at the diffusion approximation, I also need to take the limit when n goes to infinity to compute this probability. And so, eventually, we get the following. This is the limit when n goes to infinity of exactly the probability that a geometric random variable with parameter 1 over n. So this is exactly the number of the random number of generations you need to go back in time until you find the most recent common ancestor of only those two individuals. And so saying that T2 is larger than T, that means that this geometric random variable in the limit when n goes to infinity is larger not than T, but then n times t. Why do I multiply by n? Well, because in the diffusion approximation, one unit of time corresponds to n generation in the Wright-Fisher model. So eventually, you see that this probability here is just a basic probability here using the geometric random variable. Now we can compute this one explicitly. That's not very complicated. It's just the limit. Here, limit when n goes to infinity. So the probability that this geometric random variable is strictly larger than nt is exactly the probability that you have at least nt failures in a row. Probability of failure here is 1 minus 1 over n. And so eventually this probability just 1 minus 1 over n at the power nt. Now, we can compute this explicitly. Be careful, this goes to 1, this goes to infinity. So the answer is not 0 or 1, that's something in between. If you use a Taylor expansion of the log, you just said that the log of this quantity is nt times the log of 1 minus 1 over n. You use the Taylor expansion of the log, and eventually you would find that in the limit, this is exactly equal to e to the minus the product here. E at the power this term times this term, that's e to the minus t. Okay, so this means that probability that T2 is larger than T is e to the minus T, and that's exactly the same as saying that T2 is in fact a very simple random variable. T2 is exponentially distributed with parameter 1. So I'm going to write that. Conclusion of our calculation, I can write it here. Conclusion of our calculation is the fact that T2 is equal to, in distribution, to an exponential random variable with parameter 1. So now next question, what about the over times? It turns out that for the over times, so the way you think about that is really by saying that pairs of branches here, they kind of evolve independently. And so our calculation here shows that it takes an amount of time that is exponentially distributed with parameter 1, so that there is a coalescing event for each pair of branches. Now, if you look at the time Tj in general, then this is again going to be an exponential random variable. That's going to be the first time at which you have a coalescing event between two branches. And because the number, because so what we need to look at here to find this random variable is not the number of branches, but it's the number of pairs of branches, because branches coalesce by pair. And so it turns out that the time you have to wait is the minimum, it's going to be the minimum of exponential random variable with parameter 1, but you have one exponential random variable, not per branch, but per pair of branches. So if you have j branches here in your system, then that means you have j choose 2 pairs. And by the superposition property for Poisson processes, this tells you that Tj is going to be the minimum of j choose 2 independent exponential random variable with parameter 1. That's going to be an exponential random variable with parameter j choose 2. So the parameter is j choose 2. Okay, and now we are almost done with at least the probability part of the proof. The rest of the proof is just to use linearity of the expected value and also some basic algebra. So I'm going to show you how it works. Now, before I erase this picture, I remind you that in general, the time to the most recent common ancestor, if you start with n individuals, is going to be expected value of T2 plus T3 plus T4 up to Tn. And we are going to use those random variables here. So I'm going to erase all that. So now this time to the most recent common ancestor, TmrCa, is going to be equal to expected value of the sum. That's the same as the sum of the expected values. So I'm going to write the sum for, let's say, j equals 2 up to n, 2 up to n of the expected value of Tj. Now we know that Tj is exponential with this parameter. The expected value of this random variable is 1 divided by the parameter. Here the parameter is, can be written also jj minus 1 divided by 2. So that means that the mean is 2 divided by jj minus 1. So eventually we get equals the sum for j equals 2 to n of 2 divided by j times j minus 1. Okay, and so to compute this sum, that doesn't look completely easy, but you see it's supposed to simplify. I'm going to use the fact that when the theory says that 2 divided by j minus 1 can be decomposed in this form, so that's equal to A divided by J plus B divided by J minus 1. So we are going to use this decomposition. So Now, next step is to find A and B. You see that to extract the value of A, so we know that there is a unique A and B that are going to satisfy this equation. And so to find A and B, the trick is to find A, you multiply by J on both sides. So multiplying by J, this disappears here, this disappears here, and here you have a B times J, and then you take J equals zero in this equation. That gives you a 2 divided by negative 1, so that's a negative 2, is equal to A plus 0. Okay, if you take J equals 0 here, that gives you 0, so that gives you A equals negative 1. A equals negative, negative 2. And then to extract the value of B, you do the same thing. So I'm going to write again 2 divided by J, J minus 1 should be of the form A divided by J plus B divided by J minus 1. Now, instead of multiplying by J and taking J equals 0, I'm going to multiply by J minus 1 and take J equals 1. So if I multiply by J minus 1, this disappears. Here I have a J minus 1 next to the VA. If I take J equals 1, this becomes 0. And so that tells us that 2 divided by 1 is equal to B. So eventually we get that B is equal to 2. So from this little reasoning, we can deduce that this sum is also the sum for J equals 2 to N of, so we said A divided by J, but A is equal to negative 2, B divided by J minus 1, B is equal to 2, so that's A 2 divided by J minus 1 minus 2 divided by J. So eventually, we can rewrite the sum in this form. And you see that in this case, you have in fact some kind of telescopic series, because those terms here, they again appear here. There is just a shift in the index. And so eventually, what's left, I mean, if you extend this, you will see that most of the term cancel, except the first one and the last one. And so the first one is going to be 2 divided by 2 minus 1, that's a 2. And also the last term, that's exactly minus 2 divided by n here. So minus 2 over n. And then eventually we indeed obtain 2 times 1 minus 1 over n. So indeed, we were able to prove that in the diffusion approximation, so using again this geometric random variable and using this trick to decompose this fraction here, and also using the superposition property for the Poisson process, we were able to prove that indeed the time to the most recent ancestor is equal in the diffusion approximation to 2 times 1 minus 1 over n.